Talking fishing, talking fishing, nothing but fishing, talking fishing. If it's facts about fishing that you want to know, then tune in, folks, because this is the show. We'll show you all the right bait to use, so sit right back, you got nothing to lose. Doesn't really matter if it's trout or carp, flathead, marlin, or a gummy shark. Listen to the guys and you can't go wrong. They'll be talking about fishing till the cows come home. Talking fishing, talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing.
And welcome everyone to Talking Fishing, a massive show coming up as always, and what another great week in fishing it's been. The sun is shining, it's a timely reminder to protect your eyes when fishing. Tonight we take you inside the Spotters Sunglasses Factory and show you how sunglasses are made. Big Mulloway featuring this week's Catch of the Week, and we have a few hot spots for those of you heading away fishing this Melbourne Cup weekend. But before all that, a big welcome to Adam Ring, as always, Ads.
Thanks, Dave. Excuse me. Now, just before we get going here.
Yeah.
For all the viewers out there that are wondering if you've been having a little teary out there before we go, yeah, it's just the eye drops. How are the eyes going, mate?
Oh, struggling. I've had both eyes. I've had the surgery in both, and I'm struggling. Those lights that are up there in the sky behind the cameras.
Hence the trip to Spotters.
Yeah, that's it.
I need to be wearing Spotters right now. But anyway, yeah, no. I'm battling through. I'm sure long term it'll be great.
I've got the tissues down here for you.
No glasses, though.
That's it.
We're getting through the show with no glasses, so it's all good. A big welcome to Trelly as well, mate. I heard there's a whisper of some golden perch at Eildon at the moment.
Yes, has been some good reports, actually, back from Eildon on the golden perch.
Yeah.
Yeah, so the Melbourne Cup's always the weekend where it fires up. It's a bit like Easter with barramundi, and it'll just get better, I reckon.
I heard was it went off last weekend.
Yeah, really. Yeah.
But
don't tell anybody.
I was going to say those people are up there when it went off four. They're keeping that quiet. They really are. So, boys, not only yellow belly firing that, but it's been a big week in snapper again, and it's only going to accelerate at a rate of knots. Tomorrow night there is a very, very big snapper talk night down at Mornington Masda. I think we've got some details for you people at home, but it's Australia's biggest snapper talk night. It's tomorrow night. Guest speakers, we've got Sean Ferdier from Think Big Charters, Steve Johnson from Ace Fishing Charters, Scotty Harper from down at Tackle World Cranbourne, John Soldatus, he's from Kingbait, he's a fishmonger, he's going to show you how to whip the fillets off the best way. And Ads, you're going to talk a heap of product tomorrow night.
Yeah, we'll do a bit of product.
Ads, good. Ads.
If you want to get a ticket to that, there's a few seats left. You need to call either Tackle World Cranbourne or Mornington tomorrow and get along to the biggest talk night on the calendar year, which is Snapper, and it is on the eve of the big tea tree fishing comp.
It is. And the weather looks like it's come good. It was looking a bit shaky there for a little bit, but the forecast came out this morning and really looked after us and everyone that'll be fishing tea tree. Not us, we'll be making sure everyone's got a bit of fresh bait, which will get pumping out there for the tea tree comp.
That's what I love this time of year, that we get a bit of fresh bait in. So not frozen, like all year round you got frozen bait and you got a little bit of live like the yabbies and that, but for the tea tree, we've got the fresh stuff straight from the trawlers, it doesn't get any better than that.
We get Johnny Soldatus from Kingbait working overtime and making sure we got the fresh stuff.
He's at the markets meeting the fishermen at 3 a.m.
That's
for
right.
us. And
we like to think we're doing him a favour, not making him pack everything. But right. Yep.
And I probably should tell everyone that pilchards may not happen this year.
Yeah.
There's none in the market, and if the weather's good tomorrow night, the trawlers might go out. I know the guy that we normally get them off, he's gone to Thailand for holidays.
Yep.
But the guys out of Geelong, they may go out Wednesday night and get us fresh stuff for Thursday morning.
We'll see.
Probably won't arrive till about 9:30 because Johnny's got to get to the market and get it to us. So, but all good. It's going to be a very big talk night. So get your tickets if you want to tomorrow. Boys, let's have a look at what's being caught by the people at home. It's time for Catch of the Week. Mm-hmm.
Catch of the Week. You get to see yourself on TV.
Now, I mentioned in the opener what a week it's been for Mulloway. They're going to dominate in Catch of the Week this week. And boys,
I can't remember a week like this before.
No. This is Mulloway Week. It's a bit like Show Week, Grand Final Week.
Yeah, basically. Yeah.
It's been Mulloway Week. All in Western Port. And it's just been nothing short of sensational. Let's kick it off with the king of Mulloway, Warren Carter. Have a look at the size of that.
Look at that.
That is a monster.
That's amazing.
Now, that was out with Sean Ferdier on Think Big.
Yep.
And two masters of it. And That's trophy. Trophy so, stuff, isn't
it? What was that, 31 kilos of something Western like Port Mulloway?
Yeah.
That's insane. Look at that.
Yep.
That is. You'd even be happy with that, catching one of those, you know, up north off a reef.
Yeah.
Charlie, I don't know that they come much bigger than that.
Nah, that's quality.
You know, that is good. So, followed up by his partner in crime in that very well-known DVD, Brendan Wing, went out and he had a crack, and tell you what, thank you very much. That's a cracker of a fish as well.
I'm pretty sure Brendan was flying solo that night.
He was flying solo.
And,
wow. How big is that one?
I didn't see a weight on it.
Yeah.
I don't want to say, just in case. It'd have to be 20s.
If you weren't watching the show, you probably wouldn't know if those fish are out there. You know, if you're not a real fisher.
Many people wouldn't even know they're out there. Yeah, and they're just going, probably, you know, we're making it up like
but
the hotspots.
Doesn't it show you and really put into perspective how, I guess, common but not common these fish are? There's been hundreds, if not thousands, of boats fishing at night time around those Mulloway areas for snapper since early September.
Yeah.
And we've just seen four in a week, but haven't seen many reports, if any, before then.
Let's have a look at the next one. And this was probably a random catch because we know the first two guys would have been out targeting. But Chris and Colby headed out and they got a nice slapper, but also... Thank you very much for the Mulloway.
Yeah, that's a good one. Not a bad bite catch,
the old man's
it?
Pretty happy there, and that would have been a random catch, I would have thought. Yeah. You know,
I'm sure the young bloke caught the big fish. And
he just couldn't lift it. He just couldn't carry it.
Yeah, exactly.
Let's keep going. Let's keep rolling with the Mulloway, but down at a beautiful place in Western Port on the eastern side, land-based SpotX.
Land-based?
Mladen Kesajic.
Yeah.
He landed there. Now, he came into the shop. And he had his phone with him. Now that fish got released, and his hand was shaking. Hand was shaking. He came up to Gary Norton, trying to support the guts on the fish.
Look at it.
But so the next day he come in and he goes, I've just got to show you what I caught, you know, last night down at blah blah blah. And I won't give away the spots because it's a special thing. It's a special thing, and those guys that do get him really want to protect that. And I'm sorry, apologies if we offend anyone, but he came in with his hand shaking. He's going, look at my photo, you know, and. Why wouldn't
they're
you be like that?
Just a special fish.
And to let it go is just a sensational effort. Well done. So
he didn't take a picture on video, did he? And it was flapping, so that's why he was shaking.
I don't think so, Charlie. So what a week. Four Mulloway like that out of Western Port. And I think there was more. I saw Trevor and Lynette Hogan had one hanging out of the tree that had come from Western Port.
Okay.
So not just the only ones caught. I think there'd be a few others that went under the radar and we don't know about. But
would it be on approach to a moon or have we just had a moon?
No, the moon's in a couple of days' time, think so. Yeah,
prime time.
Let's head up to Lake Hume now. And Thomas Pinter sent us in this photo of some very, very nice golden perch. It's the time for golden perch, Charlie. Like I said, the whispers came from Lake Eildon, but obviously up at Lake Hume, it's a little bit warmer up there and it certainly seems to be on fire.
Well, we probably don't. We have been actually getting reports from Lake Hume for about the last month.
Yep.
With really good sized yellow belly or golden perch.
Yep.
So we're just sort of starting to see that in Eildon, but I probably haven't mentioned it because it's a bit out of our area, but Hume has been fishing really, really well.
Yeah.
So, and I reckon I know Tom quite well through my time at Tuckall or Cranbourne, and I reckon he'll feature a bit. He's got a nice little tub now with the electric on the front, and he'll be getting amongst these freshwater natives right throughout the summer.
Yeah. Lucky last, and it is trout season as well, don't forget. And Jason Kilpatrick got this lovely one in the Latrobe River.
It's a cracking fish for the Latrobe.
That's a beautiful fish. What a pretty area. I mean, we don't talk about that area often enough.
Down
Noogee and that sort of places. And I mean, quality fish like that. He got a few smaller ones on that day, he wrote to me, but that is just a classic of
a
beautiful fish.
Easy to access.
I think that one went 1.1 kilo.
That's a beautiful fish.
That's a lovely little trout stream fish. Yep. So, I know the Goulburn fished very, very well today. There's someone up there that sent some text messages through.
Interesting.
With about 20 odd rainbows today. So
nice.
Lower Goulburn, below the...
just at Thornton.
Thornton, yeah.
So it's breakaway there.
It's nice there.
So some pretty good fish around, boys. And I know it's snapper season. We didn't feature snapper, but those fish were just too...
You can't go past
four non-snapper were just too good not to feature.
Them.
So.
Yeah.
If you'd like to send in a pic of your catch of the week, this is what you have to do.
If you want to be like me and have your photo on TV, email your fishing pic to info@ifish.com.au.
And coming up on Talking Fishing Product of the Week, and we take you inside the Spotters Sunglasses Factory straight after this on Talking Fishing.
Talking Fishing. Make mine a Mornington.
G'day, David Kramer here. I'm a massive fan of the Mazda BT50, having personally driven and owned one for more than 5 years now. And to tell you what, you can't beat them for an all-round great ute and a great tow vehicle. Get into Mornington Mazda before the end of the month and grab yourself a run-out bargain. Plus, with every BT50, you get all this $500 worth of fishing gear for free. I made mine a Mornington Mazda.
Make mine a Mornington Mazda.
Product of the week. Brought to you by Tackle World. Now with 8 great locations around Victoria. Tackle World, where our advice is priceless. That's why it's for free.
See you down at Tackle World today.
Talking fishing, talking fishing. Nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing.
Quite often in the tackle shops, we get asked, new people getting into native fishing. So it's the yellow belly, it's the cod, and even redfin. People say, what's the best rod? Do I use my whiting rod, my flathead rod, my snapper rod? Because us salties haven't got much of a clue about these big natives, Trelly. But you've designed a range of rods with Shimano called the Bandit series.
Correct.
And you've brought them along. You're going to show us what they're all about. And this is what people are looking for, because more and more people are getting into that, getting up to Eildon now. It's been stocked with 1 million cod.
The
yellow belly, like we were saying, they're going off, and they will go off in future weeks.
Correct.
This is what people are missing from their range of rods, isn't it?
Well, I believe that, and you're right, over the years, we go through all these rods and bits and pieces, and we go, we wish we had one that had done this, had this certain quality or length, especially with the natives up our way. And what we've done is it's been very good to work with Shimano over that period of time, and we've developed these range of rods called the Bandit series. Now, there's actually 20 in this range, 20 rods in this range that we've worked on over the years. So what we've done, this is the sort of top end of this particular series. As you can see, cosmetically they're upgraded with cork grips.
Yep.
They've got better fittings. They've got lovely cosmetics. So, and it's one thing, it's about the fishing, but it's about looking good while you're fishing too.
Yeah.
So which is important. But these things, the property of these things, match up with the style of fishing that we do for our natives. Yeah. This particular one here is a little bait caster. Now, it's called the Black Star. Now, it's just under 6 foot long, and it's got its bend is really it is really pointed towards casting spinnerbaits or bait fishing, because a lot of times up in the country, a guy walking in and say, now I'm after something, I'm going yellow belly fishing, but I want to do a bit of cod fishing. So you really need two rods. I don't want two rods, I want to buy a run rod today, you know. So I would say that's on the light end of cod. And it hits the mark with the yellow belly and your redfin. So you can do it. You can fish that. And we've tried to introduce that through the whole rod series. Something that's a little bit heavier in that one there, pointed at the cod, but it's also just light enough for the yellow belly. And that's just
is that bait cast or spin, Charlie?
That's a spin one there.
Yeah. Okay. That so you grip hold of that, and I don't know if we can get a shot. But I mean, what's that rated to?
That's a 5 to 8 kilo.
5 to 8 kilo.
Yeah.
That'll handle any decent cod. I know I'm putting a bit of pressure on that, but that is a beautiful. And people are missing that. If you think you're going to use your snapper rod, it's normally a 7.2 to 7.6 or whatever, or 7.8. This is just a nice short, but got that strength in it, hasn't it?
Explain the length to Australia, because it's something, I guess, at home we're not accustomed to short rods.
Yeah. One of the things with the length, if you're in a boat, you're tangling into your tip.
Yep.
You just want to get to it with one hand, and you still with the hand on the reel.
Yeah.
That's something very simple. Plus, it fits in your ute, or it fits in your car.
Yeah, all that
type of thing. Whereas these guys down here put them in boats.
Yeah, that's right.
But these are starting to double up, as you mentioned before, Ads, with the kayak fishing for snapper and things.
It's one thing that's been received quite well down in Mornington, where kayaking and kayak fishing is becoming quite popular, as we've got access to deep water quickly, so you're not travelling too far offshore. Mm. And the kayak guys are quite excited about them because they are short, so they're easy to manage.
Yeah.
You're not breaking tips or you're trying to net fish in bits and pieces.
Yeah.
Now this one's a bit longer, Trelly.
This one's actually your whiting rod down here, which we would use for a mud eye rod.
Yeah, okay.
So that's your whiting that these guys would use down here. Yep. And you can see the cosmetics through this series with this particular reel here. I don't know if you can get a close up of that one there. That particular reel there, I mean, they just match up perfectly.
Yeah.
So for a Christmas gift, we'll have these.
For balance, cosmetics, all that sort of stuff. That's an ideal.
Yeah, I was going to say, that reel's been quite a popular reel for years through all of our stores.
Yeah, spare spool.
Yep. So, which one of the few reels that still does come with a spare spool.
So excellent product, Shimano, excellent brand. and fits all, ticks all the boxes for us.
Yeah. It's designed specifically for, well, I guess our native fishery.
Exactly.
Yeah. You got them in all your shops, Trolley?
We've got those in all our shops, and you've got them in ours.
So, yeah. Yep.
So, so you can call in, have a bit of a look at those, keeping in mind that they are pointed towards the native market, but they will double up, you know, down Geelong way for some of the lakes down there for redfin, that type of thing. But pretty much boat and bank freshwater, freshwater series.
Yeah, beautiful. There is the Shimano Bandit series. Get into your local tackle shop and have a look at those, because they are a fantastic unit, and something I bet a lot of you people are missing from your range of fishing rods is that short, strong rod for some of those natives.
Yep.
It's not only native season, it's the sunny season.
Correct.
And the old sunshine is out, the UV rays are getting it.
Yep.
This is the time when the people walk into your shop and they've got the sunglasses, Mark, haven't they?
They've been, lenses in their eyes.
Yeah, they've been out in the sun and it's blinding and it's sunburn and all that sort of stuff. But one of the most important things, and I'm, you know, number one to know it because I've just had my cataracts surgically removed and I've had lens implants into the eye to try and keep the eyes going for the rest of my life. And one of the biggest things is protect your eyes from the sun. Our good friends at Spotters let us into their factory, and we filmed a little bit of a trip down there. Let's have a look at what we saw.
There's two very important things when it comes to your eyes and fishing. Number one, protect them from the sun. You're out there in the beautiful sunshine catching your beautiful fish. You've got to look after your eyes. They're your greatest asset. Number two, have polarized lenses. You've got to see the fish. You've got to see the structure. You want to do everything you can to give you that little bit of edge catching the big fish. We're here at the headquarters of Spotters Sunglasses today. Now, Jason Portelli is the face of Spotters in Victoria, if not Australia. If you haven't seen him, this is the man. Jason, how long have you been around Spotters Sunglasses?
11 years, Dave.
And how long has the company been around?
21 years.
This factory that we're looking at here today, Kilsyth, how many different lenses, frames, combinations of glasses are there?
Currently 24.
Yep, with lenses?
11 different lenses.
Now, 11 times 24, I've got no idea what that is, and I bet you don't either, but it's a lot of sunglasses. Now, we're going to grab Stu Griffiths. He's the optical mechanic here at Spotters Sunglasses. He's going to take us for a tour of the factory and have a look at how Spotters Sunglasses are made.
So, basically what I do is block the lenses here. As you can see, they're our Nexus lenses. They're a green with a blue tinge. Once they're blocked up, fit them into the machine here, and the machine has a template to the shape of the frame that we cut in this case it's a droid.
So does every lens starts in that shape?
It actually starts a lot thicker.
Oh,
and you've already ground the face.
The horizontal lines that you can't see but they're in there, they'll stop the reflection off the water like that. So, but like that, it'll allow it straight through. So if you get two polarized lenses and twist them one in front of the other, they'll go black. So it'll cut out the total light coming through. It fits in there. So we've got a little hand edger here. Just take the sharp edges off the lens. This takes all the little the chips and any dags that may be on the lens off.
So Stu, what's this?
This is a heat bead box. So we've got hot glass beads in here. So what we do is we put the frame in. It makes the frame warm and pliable, so it moves and is able to be manipulated around. Just pretty much fit them in like that. Make sure they're tight. These lenses are for our prescription wearers.
Yep.
Now, the reason they're so thick is so we can accommodate for up to a +2 or a -2, so we can grind anything between that range on here. This is our halide lens. It's the darker version of the penetrator. Now, these two will go slightly darker in the sun. Also, will our extreme yellow, that also goes a little bit darker. But that's generally for lighter conditions, say trout fishing and Tassie rivers, that sort of thing. Overcast days. Silver mirror, gold mirror are also available.
Now everyone, this is Drummo. Drummo is half blind most of the time and fully blind the rest of the time. Jace, if someone like Drummo walks into a tack world and says, I want prescription spotters, can you do it?
Certainly can, yes. Pretty much what we need is a fairly fresh prescription for an optometrist, and we can make up a design pair of prescriptions just for Drummo. In his own powers.
So
I've just got glasses myself and I can't read without them. I'm about a two, a plus two.
Yep.
What can you go up to in prescription?
Pretty much plus two, two and a half in glass.
Stu, what's this machine? Tell us about it.
Well, basically what we do with this machine is we pop a pair of glasses in, hit start, and it will spin around and it determines the axis of the lenses and make sure they're within a couple of degrees of 180.
Now, if you want a cheaper lens than glass, you have the option of Columbia resin. It is one of the best resins from around the world, and this is how they make them. So Stu, someone makes a tray of glasses. Obviously this is a Thunder.
Yep.
What do you do with it now?
We have a print machine that will print the spotter's logo. And in this case, we have a halide symbol because it's a halide lens. Whereas the non-halide lenses will just come with the spotter's logo.
Now, a tray of glasses has been printed with a little spotter's logo on the lens.
Yep.
Comes to here. What happens here? Correct.
Well, main and quality control team will lay them out on the bench like this. And they'll check for bent screws, make sure they're straight, make sure the lenses have no gaps or anything like that. And then from this point, they'll wrap them up and present them nicely in a tin, and then they go out to you guys in the shops.
Well, there you have it. That's how you make a pair of these sunglasses. I'd really like to thank Jace. Thanks, mate. Appreciate the tour. We now know a lot more about these.
There you have it.
Spotter sunglasses,
that's good. Sunglasses aren't just made in China and shipped in big containers.
Yeah, that's good to see.
It is. That's really local stuff, and they've been around, would Jay say,
22 years, 21 years?
Yeah. So great manufacturing in Australia, and everyone knows, and here's all the bad stories. There is a quality product that is made in Australia, and it's just absolutely fantastic for Kim and Frank and Danny and the family that are spotters, and I know Jace is almost part of the family, to let us in and see that sort of stuff, because it's not every day you get to see that sort of unbelievable manufacturing in Australia.
An optical engineer that says DAGs.
You picked up on that, didn't you? And we did Product of the Week a couple of weeks ago, all the different lenses.
We did.
You know, so you get to see it there. That starts off as a bit of glass about that.
It's huge. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Mm. It just gets made into
that. You used to say in the old days, look at that bloke over, he got bottoms of Coke bottles for glasses.
But yeah.
Not anymore.
No. And I wish I'd have worn sunglasses when I was younger. I mean, got the first boat when I was 18. There was no sunnies back then. You had no sunblock.
Yeah.
Didn't even wear a hat, you know.
Yeah.
Had the hair down to here somewhere. But, you know, flowing locks.
Too,
but,
yeah.
But, you know, I mean, all those years and cataracts, and it's not good. Yeah. So, you know, people just need to protect their eyes. They really do.
It's a good investment.
Yeah. Absolutely.
That's a great investment.
And a great quality.
Yeah.
Yeah. Your cheaper sunglasses, you'll get all your cheapies and all that sort of stuff too. But if you want something that's going to last a lifetime and look after the greatest assets in your life.
Correct.
You just saw where to go. Coming up on Talking Fishing, fisheries news, and it's all about getting rid of the nets in Port Phillip Bay right after this.
Talking Fishing.
Talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing. And now it's time for the news, the fisheries news. Sounds a bit fishy to me.
Now, if you haven't heard the news, this is probably the biggest news of the fishing year, if not the decade, and if not the century, and I'm serious. We all know that last year, Jacinta Allen sat in the chair with us and announced that the Labor government were going to ban netting in Port Phillip Bay. 2 weeks prior to that, the Premier, Dennis Napthine, stood on the shores of Carrum down at the Bowling Club and said he will, if he gets back into power, he will ban netting in Port Phillip Bay. Last Thursday, the Labor government introduced legislation to end commercial netting in Port Phillip Bay, and that legislation will be introduced into Parliament. It was first introduced, last Thursday, delivering on a key element of the Andrews Labor government's plan to boost recreational fishing. The introduction of the Fisheries Amendment Bill 2015 will commence the process to phase out commercial net fishing over the next 7 years to improve recreational fishing opportunities. Boys, this is it. This is the thing that starts the ball rolling in a big way.
Yep.
The bill will specify a clear pathway for phasing out nets for Port Phillip Bay by 2022, including the closure of Corio Bay to netting by the 1st of April 2018. So no matter what, if this gets through, Corio Bay is closed from the 1st of April 2018. No more net fishing. Even
That's
though
huge.
Some people yep. may not have handed their licence in yet, the nets will be closed in Corio Bay from 1st of April 2018. Great news. Next, specify how compensation payments will be determined for the 43 license holders who will be affected by this decision. So in this legislation, there's a formula, and we'll actually talk about that later on. This will provide for a limited non-net commercial fishery of up to 8 license holders to operate in Port Phillip Bay from 1st of April 2022. So all the way along we've said, this is not a ban of commercial fishing in Victoria. There's plenty of commercial fishing that will still occur in Victoria. There is a massive commercial fishery offshore.
Yep.
It's in Commonwealth waters, and there's a lot of fish that come to market. In fact, plenty more than what comes out of Port Phillip Bay. But there will also be 8 licences allowed to commercially fish in Port Phillip Bay, but they'll be restricted to using long lines. And I'll tell you about some more details about that. And it'll provide the provide for the first licences to be surrendered from the 1st of April 2016. So no netting licences will be bought out right now, but they start to be bought out on the 1st of April 2016. Just to elaborate on a bit of this, the Labor government recognises that this decision impacts on the livelihood of 43 commercial licence holders, many of whom are multi-generational fishers with a strong family connection to the industry. That's why, following consultation with the fishers and their representative body, Seafood Industry Victoria, the bill includes a revised package of up to $27 million to compensate affected licence holders. So originally the promise was $20 million, boys. It's now 27 million. They've done the sums, they've worked out what the formulas are, and it may require $27 million to buy out. That's paying the maximum amount. Now, there's some things in there that reduce the amount, so we'll get into that a bit later. So this was introduced on Thursday. If you went back a couple of days before that on the Tuesday, now, bear in mind, the opposition promised to do it at the same time. Simon Ramsay, he's the member for Western Victoria, he got into Parliament, and I won't read you the whole transcript I've got here of Hansard of that day in Parliament, but he virtually said, "I ask the Minister to call for a review of the current policy and delay any decision until such time as the outcomes of an environmental impact and social study on the Port Phillip Bay and Corio Bay fishery is completed." Now, I can't believe this guy, Simon Ramsay. I don't know what party he's out of, but certainly doesn't seem to be out of the party or either party that said that they would ban commercial netting in Port Phillip Bay as a policy.
Yeah.
This guy just looks like a loose cannon. Simon Ramsay.
He's trying to have his say there, but again, we're targeting the practices that...
If you know politics, Trelly, and you come out with an election policy, you toe the party line. This guy isn't part of the party, and seriously, needs to be seriously spoken to, which I think he has. A couple of days later, Peter Walsh, who was the former Minister for Fisheries and he's now the Shadow Minister for Agriculture, he came out and said the Coalition support for Bay Licence buyback is unchanged. The Liberal Nationals Coalition continues to support a buyback of commercial netting licences for Port Phillip Bay, including Corio Bay. Both myself and Matthew Guy have met with recreational fishing and commercial fishing representatives, and stakeholders in recent weeks, and we've made it clear that we remain committed to the policy we took to the last election. So we thank you very much, Peter Walsh, for clarifying that, because your old mate Simon Ramsay, I'm not sure that he agrees with you, and just a little bit of a disruption in the process. Yep. But I tell you what, as a group of anglers, people are going to be pretty annoyed if the Coalition blocks this in Parliament, because it takes the Coalition vote to get it through. Because the Greens, would you believe, They want commercial fishing. They want the nets that pull up all the seagrass and kill all the juvenile fish and throw them to the
bankers.
Bankers. That's the one. So very quickly, I'm going to run through the compensation package. And sorry, there's probably not a lot of question time after this, but we'll try and do it later. For each license, you get $310,000 compensation. That's license. No questions asked. $310,000. Then you get $75,000. To help with asset disposal. So you might own nets that you're going to put on eBay. People might want to buy them. You might have to take a loss on them because there's no more netting in the bay. 75 grand. So you get 385 all up. Then you get paid as a license holder 3 years of your catch multiplied by the market value. And that 3 years is calculated as your average over the past 5 years leading in to the election. So it doesn't matter how hard you fish since the election, the 5 years before the election, they take the average, and you get three times that average at market price. And in the legislation, there's dollar values for every species that would be netted in Port Phillip Bay. But if you decide not to get out on April 2016 and you wait a year, your payout reduces by 10%. And if you wait another year, your payout reduces by another 10%. And if you wait another year, your payout reduces all the way through to 2022. But by April 2022, every net must be out of Port Phillip Bay.
So it's encouragement to get out early.
Absolutely. Yeah, we talked about the eight longliners, and those eight longliners that remain in the commercial industry, they will share an 88-ton quota, so they'll get 11 ton each. Some of those guys have netting components to their licenses. They can hand in their netting license, and they get $205,000 in compensation. No market value, just a set rate, $205,000. So it's interesting stuff. Some of these guys, when you add their catch, they're facing well over $1 million in payouts. It's pretty big stuff. We've run out of room in this break. If we get time, we'll get back to this after the next break. But up next, Kramer's Mailbag and plenty more on Talking Fishing.
Talking Fishing.
We know what you'd rather be doing.
We know what you've really got in mind.
We know you'd rather be out fishing. And today's the day you're gonna wet a line.
'Cause every day's a good day. Stop wishing. Every day's a chance to drift away.
Drift away.
Every day's a good day for fishing.
Every day.
See you down at Tackle World today.
Talking fishing, talking fishing. Nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing.
Now we'll try and get back into the netting issues straight after Kramer's Mailbag. Let's get into it. The first one is from Neil McKenzie Acker, the Rod Father.
The Rod Father.
Hi, love your show. It's the one thing I look forward to watching each week. Isn't that nice to hear? I know you probably get 1 million and one snapper picks at this time of year, but here is 1 million and two. I think we've got a photo of him there. This fish was taken on the weekend out from our toner during our first annual family snapper comp. Awesome for the kids and the whole family. There is eight boats in total with a small entry fee, which pays for the plaque, trophies, and weigh-in barbecue. How good's that?
Cool.
A family does that. This fish took out the comp at 5.7 kilos thanks to listening to your hotspots report. We also took out boat and the most fish, and my dad got runner-up to the biggest taken. Thanks again and congratulations on your first anniversary. Tight lines, Neil McKenzie. Thank you, Neil.
Good job, Neil.
Appreciate it.
And I love it.
Isn't it great to see families running little comps and little trophies and all that?
That's what it should be about.
Fishing is all about.
Correct.
Family, getting outside. The next one from Lucene Keane, I think it is. Hi, Kramer.
The look on your face.
Hi, Kramer. I'm a long-time viewer, but first-time caller. I've got to say, I'll be tuning out from now on. Very disappointed with your banter section relating to the treatment of conservation of dolphins. I have a long-standing respect for such an incredible ocean creature with social skills which rival yours.
All right. Carry on.
You offended me amongst other dolphin lovers, and I will be sharing this disgruntled review with all of my marine mammal loving friends.
Both of them.
Regards. Regards, once loyal viewer. P.S. No one believes your images of the dolphins playing poker. For crying out loud, they looked fake.
No.
No.
Did we use a fake image of dolphins right, playing
on.
Poker?
Hang on. Have you finished reading that?
Yeah.
All right.
I just before we get into it, because it's a bit mind-boggling, but anyway.
Before the bus comes.
I just want to clear something up. We've got absolutely nothing against dolphins.
No.
But they don't even taste any good.
Yeah. I was trying to be serious.
Sorry.
We've got nothing against dolphins.
No, we have respect for them. That listen, dolphin sanctuary thing where they say they socialise and we spotted them playing poker in
this
there.
Is what I'm not even going to bother.
Can we move on?
Thanks, Luke.
Keep going. Thanks for your mail. G'day, Dave. One of your letter... Oh, this is from Ross Winstanley. He is just a genius when it comes to the real serious stuff. G'day, Dave. One of your letter writers spoke about problems with fine green weed covering baits. I had the same problem last week while fishing next to the channel inside Corio Bay. In a strong run-out tide, my baits and bottom rigs were being enveloped by masses of the green filaments of this stuff. That was from last week, that photo up there. It's a worldwide marine species, Enteromorpha, that typically grows in fixed clumps or drifting mats in spring and summer before decomposing. It thrives in seawater with a combination of warming temperatures and excessive nutrient levels. It's popular in New South Wales as a ludric bait and is the fine algae that grows on intertidal rocks, ramps and steps that make them incredibly slippery to step on. There you go, yeah, Ross. Yeah. Thank you very much for that.
And, so it's good
hopefully
bait.
It decomposes and goes away. Only for ludric.
Yep.
And lucky last, g'day, gents. I wear prescription glasses and have always wondered if this prevents me from purchasing a proper pair of polarised sunglasses for fishing. Any advice would be appreciated. Dwayne Penza. Dwayne, if you were watching 10 minutes ago, you would have seen the tour of Spotter's Factory.
Yep.
And Jason explained that bring your latest prescription in to any tackle shop that sells Spotter sunglasses and they'll fix you up to 2.5, I think. So that's it. If you'd like to write to me or these blokes, this is what you do.
Send your mail to Kramer's Mailbag, PO Box 734, Paterson Lakes, Victoria 3197, or email kramer@ifish.com.au.
They
were loose, don't laugh.
Cameraman's laughing. They were playing poker. It was a...
It doesn't get much more legit.
It was a quiet game. It wasn't fake. How dare they say that we had fake photos on? Anyway, just on the fishing stuff. So there's a couple of things that I think could be rewritten on this.
Yeah. Well, just before we...
I've got a question. You've got to start on. You love dolphins.
I've got a question on this.
Yeah.
On the netting, but I forget the dolphins. They're no good. They don't taste any good. With the netting buyback... I'm not across this as much as what you guys are, so I'm going to ask a question. Is a decrease by 10% per year enough for these commercial fishermen to want to hand in their licences early? Oh, and this is a legitimate question. I don't know. I've got no opinion. I don't know. Is it enough?
Do you want to answer it? I reckon it is for some operators. So if you're a small-time operator with a small catch, it's going to diminish fairly quickly. And if your income's, if you're only a part-timer in the industry or whatever, you need to get out.
Yeah.
Yep.
If you're a big-timer and say you're earning $300,000 a year from netting fish, and some guys, have got fairly big quotas, they weigh up that losing 10%. Say they were going to get $1 million payout. Say over that time they might lose $200,000 or $250,000, but for the next 8 years they're paid $300,000 a year, then they could probably say, no, I'm going to stay in. I'm earning real good money. I'm going to keep earning my $300,000 a year, but it's going to cost me 200 and something in the payout. So I think there'll be a lot of accountants looking over the packages right now.
Exactly.
And look, I mean, we as a group, Future Fish Foundation, after Trelly, we push for some sort of an incentive program, and I think it's a very, very fair incentive program that they've introduced. Something that I'm not happy about, and I've made it pretty vocal, is that I think Corio Bay should be closed a lot sooner than 2018. I think, potentially that should be closed on the 1st of April 2016. It's time to close Corio Bay. The other thing I'm not particularly happy with is that I think if you're a commercial fisher, that has an interest in staying in the longline industry, the rules in the legislation are that you have to wait till 2022 before getting your $205,000 to stop netting. And what I think is that they should have the option to sell their netting component now.
Straight away.
And then...
Start.
Keep longlining.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But get their $205,000 in compensation now. That gets their netting out of the bay, and they long line under their merry way under the cap catch system, because there is a cap catch system that they can only catch what they caught, or, you know, whatever formula. And then 2022, the new quota system comes in and they get their 11 tonne a year. So I think they're two things for improvement, you know. So,
like you say, they'll be weighing up the figures and how they go about it, and a different operator is going to benefit in different ways.
Yeah.
But it's good that they've got to be properly compensated.
Yeah, exactly. So, it's a big thing, and you know, from day one, we've always said to the politicians, this needs to be a compassionate buyout. Now, some people are going to get paid a very lot of money. Trelly, you were talking during the break that it's probably going to be tax-free. Well, I'd say it would be tax-free when you get something like this.
I think it would be tax-free, because when you had the gun buyback in 96, I mean, the money to receive for your gun was tax-free.
Yeah.
Although they didn't want my cartridge belt or my Labrador dog, but they're going to pay them out for their nets.
So they wouldn't take your dog?
No. I had to retire him.
Shocking.
Coming up, this week's hot spots and what's coming up on C31 Fishing. Be back shortly on Talking Fishing.
Talking Fishing.
G'day, Helen here from Paul Worsland's Tackle World Cranbourne.
Supercharged batteries have been supplying maintenance-free marine batteries since 2001. The Seamaster Gold Range is second to none, delivering superior starting power and reserve capacity. No need to top up with water, truly a fit and forget battery. With up to 2 years replacement warranty, you know you have quality. Your battery is your lifeline. Without it, you're dead in the water because it's bloody hard to push start.
I've got a Seamaster battery in my boat.
Make yours a Seamaster Gold today.
Talking fishing, talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing.
Hello, Richie Minnow here. It's now time for this week's fishing hotspots on Talking Fishing. Marvellous.
Yeah, thank you, Richie Minnow. And just during the break, Trelly got on the old Google machine on his phone and he's worked out that they're not bad when they're smoked. Let's get into the hotspots and let's kick it off.
Apparently.
Edith Vale, 13 metres of water is the hotspot this weekend if you want to get a snapper. Just head not too deep.
Heading into Tea Tree?
Yep.
That's your Tea Tree tip?
Edith Vale. Yep. Go shallow.
There you go.
Don't go out to 20, 21 or anything like that. Edith Vale shallow is the place to go.
12 metres, 10 metres?
Oh, yeah, 12, 13 metres. Yep. That'd be the spot.
I like it.
If you're in Western Port, I would go to Elizabeth Island.
Not a bad bet. Yep. I like it.
Two Tea Tree tips, that's it. If you get our fishing report every week, you'll probably get an email tomorrow with some GPS marks.
Some sneaky GPS marks.
Yeah, we haven't told anyone about that, but some sneaky GPS marks will be sent out. Six of the best.
You've been poaching again.
What area?
Yep. Both bays, because the Tea Tree, you're allowed
Edith
to fish
Vale
both bays.
And, so. Edith Vale and Elizabeth Island. Okay.
No, but there'll be a few GPS marks out in the email. Wait for that tomorrow. Now, many people are going away this weekend. It's a big weekend for people fishing. I would have said until they introduce the grand final public holiday, this is usually the first public holiday that people get away fishing.
Right. Yep.
And the Melbourne Cup weekend, it is. Many people take the Monday off, and it's 4 days of fantastic fishing.
It's the mark of a lot of people's snapper season.
We talk
about the AFL Grand Final as the start of as a retailer, the start of our snapper season.
Yeah.
For a lot of fishermen, this is the start of snapper season for them.
So, but it's not only snapper, because people travel. So we thought the next four hotspots, let's take people out into the country.
Yep.
And number one would be Anderson's Inlet.
I'm sorry,
it's going to be packed down there.
It is a beautiful spot.
But the thing about Anderson's Inlet this time of year is that the trevally, the salmon, they tend to, they're still there, but they tend to move out, and a few of the King George whiting come in on the weed beds. It can be a very, very transitional time of year where you can virtually catch anything. At night, you'll get a nice gummy in the inlet.
Yeah, that's right. My big tip, grab yourself a bait pump, get stuck into the Bass Shabbies.
Yes.
It is the only King George whiting bait at Anson's Inlet.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Number one.
No netting?
No netting.
No, so the netting was banned there about 8 or 9 years ago. That's why it's so fantastic. Price of fish didn't go up when they banned it in Anderson's Inlet either. Lake Tyres is the second one, and I spoke to Frank Melito today, and he said Lake Tyres is already like Bourke Street, and it's going to get it's going to be like the intersection of Swanson and Flinders by this weekend. So big flathead are emerging. Paul got one 87 centimetres a couple of weeks ago. I heard there was a 1 metre caught this week, so pretty big spot
down
there.
The brim would start getting up on the edges too.
Yep.
Bit of surface action in the morning and the evening. Oh, it'd be beautiful.
Yeah, great Lake Tyres. Let's head up now to Lake Eildon, and we were talking earlier on, Charlie, the yellow belly you know, whispers are that they went off.
Yeah, that's
this
right.
This will be the big start of it, won't it, this weekend?
And where would you look, Trelly? Would you be looking deep still? Would you be using vibes and bobbers and bits and pieces, or would you be getting up on the flats and hitting a few shallow drop-offs? Or
yeah, you pretty much sums it all up.
Would I be right? Start around that deletide arm, but probably near just before Bonnie Doone, you know, that area.
Yeah, work your there's a couple of good rocky banks right on that point there where you work. The wall, you know, the big rock walls at the actual wall, the wall, around that area is also good. Yep. But yeah, working down a deltoid arm, try your trees, use your sounder. Sometimes they'll sit above trees, so look like some fish that sit sort of like above trees or half up the water column.
Yep. Interesting.
If you spot yellow belly on your sounder, what's your best method then? If you've spotted them, what do you do? Bait? Lure, what do you do?
I would lure first.
Yep.
Pretty much cast what you think is past the point.
Yep.
When I was up there one day, I was sounding into the smaller bay. So use your sounder, you know, in one direction, and we were picking up fish, just odd ones. And there was one particular point there, part cast past, and we picked up, saw two fish, and we caught two yellow belly.
Yep.
So that was really good results. But and you'd see them like that. But yeah, bibless lures are probably one of the most used up there.
If you sound them mid-water. If we were in Port Phillip Bay and sound a snapper mid-water, we wouldn't bother. We'd keep driving.
Yeah.
Is it the same with yellow belly? Do they need to be on the bottom or what's...
No, they don't really. You just put a jag down. You might catch them in your arm or leg or anywhere, but, you know. But no, you can. Or you can work, you know, you control pass.
I would have said you're silly about saying that fish have got arms or legs, but the dolphins can hold cards.
Yeah,
so
no, well, that's right.
That's must
but
be
you will,
true.
But you will catch them mid-water.
You will catch them mid-water. Absolutely, yeah. Yep. Yeah. Just work lures. Baits, not so much, but work your lures, that type of thing.
All right, better finish off the last hotspot. I know many, many people will be heading to the beautiful town of Ballarat. Lake Windaree is fishing sensationally, by all reports, for nice trout.
Yep.
And many people going there will probably not take a fishing rod. Do yourself a favour, take a fishing rod, because Windaree is fishing the best it has in many, many years. And there you go. There's our hotspots. Let's have a look at what's coming up on Channel 31. If you're not going to the races and you're staying at home and you're just going to lounge about on the lounge, you can watch a bit of C31 fishing tonight, catch and cook. Tomorrow morning is On the Fly at 6:30 in the morning. Thursday morning, if you want to watch a repeat of this show, it's on at 7 a.m. and then Thursday night is On the Fly. Friday there's a couple of shows in the morning, AFN, and we watched that episode tonight, didn't we, before we come on air from Malakuta, another lovely
some
spot to go from the Melbourne Cup. Well done, Billy Classen.
On the surface.
And Ufish TV's on at 7, and then Saturday the big extravaganza runs from 10 to 1 and then 6 through to 8 o'clock. Plenty of fishing coming up on C31, boys.
There you go.
Charlie, the cod season doesn't start till December 1.
Correct.
But are people going to start catching cod now that the water warms up a bit?
It does. It's usually a byproduct of, you know, trying to chase yellow belly. So using smaller spinner baits, or you're trying to downsize your hooks and, you know, put small yabbies or big bunches of worms on. And I was actually talking, being up there on the weekend with Mary, and caught a couple of little trout cod because they're pretty aggressive.
Yeah.
You know, you just take the pin out of them and throw them back in.
So how big?
Oh, it was only probably 20 centimetres, I suppose.
Yeah, yeah.
But byproduct as far as you're trying to chase yellow bean.
But just got to get them back in the water as soon as you can because it's close season.
Yeah, it's pretty easy. Yeah, they usually just, you know, pull a hook out pretty easy.
So yeah. Don't forget, people at home, a big snapper talk night tomorrow night. I meant to mention that. And if you want to get along to it, it's at Mornington Mazda. It starts at the talk starts at 7. Get there at 6:30 for pizza and soft drinks. It's a big night with Sean Ferdier from Think Big Charters, Steve Johnson from Ace Fishing Charters, Scotty Harper from Tackwell Cranbourne, John Soldatus from Kingbait, and Adam Ring from Tackwell Mornings, and talking a bit of tackle and all the gear you need for snapper, all the latest and greatest.
That's it.
Big night. Get your tickets in the morning by calling through to either Tackle World, Cranbourne or Mornington.
Yep.
Be a big night. So cod, that'll hot up. Snapper, it's been fantastic. Be interesting to see. So we've got full moon, I think, in a couple of days. Whether we see any more Mulloway come out of Western Port.
Mm. We'd have to. With so many boats out this tea tree, and generally we do see a big Mulloway tea tree weekend.
Yeah.
Just through weight of numbers.
Yeah, be interesting. I'm not an expert in Mulloway by far, so yeah, I'm not sure.
I've never caught them in Western Port.
Something turned them on last week, obviously, and you know, those guys, I know most of them are pretty experienced guys and just know where to target them and what conditions. It's pretty specialist stuff. So the other thing I heard is some kingfish starting to get around.
I saw a couple of pictures.
Yeah, videos. The videos doing the rounds. There were some big fish
We were talking the other day that, yeah. I mean, I fish Montague Island a lot, as people know. I go up to Narooma almost every Christmas, and it's the kingfish aren't just there in the Christmas holidays. Yeah. You know? Now, I mean, they're there, they're not. In Victoria, and particularly like the Rip, Cape Shank, out the back of Phillip Island, that yep. people seem to only target them January, February, March, then it's all over.
Yeah. You know? Yeah.
I'm sure if someone tried, they'd be there now.
They'd have to.
There is a couple of sneaky reports coming in.
Yeah.
With them, you know, out the front there, the Rip.
Yeah.
But, like you say, they'll probably target them more and more now.
It's a growing fishery, and I think if people were targeting them now, they would certainly be catching them.
Yep.
And it's just something that we'd love to see some photos. If anyone is out there this Melbourne Cup weekend, just have a go. Normal, you know, there's no special way to get them early season.
Here's a thought. We snap a fish on structure, we try to. A lot of people will be fishing in close, whether it's from Mornington, around the rocks, whatever. Stick a live bait out. Have your snapper rods down, that's all right.
Yeah.
Just have a livey sitting out the back there at the side under a float, just doing its thing, and wait for it to scream off. What do you got to lose?
Well, what's the worst could happen?
Get a kingfish.
That's right.
Get a dolphin.
And you get your photo on.
It's a pretty special time of year. That's it for Talking Fishing. If we don't see you at the big snapper talk night tomorrow night, we hope you have a great Melbourne Cup weekend of fishing. Remember, next Tuesday night show is a pre-recorded one due to Cup Day. But until then, stay safe on the water and enjoy your fishing.
Talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing. We got all you need, just take a look. Watch those fish jump on your hook. So just relax and take your time. Enjoy the show, then drop us a line. Talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing. Talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing. Talking fishing.
Have a good weekend, Mr. Walker.
You too, son.